This is Ecuador, April 2020. The coronavirus pandemic is wreaking disaster on the community. The Ecuadorians don't have enough space in the hospitals for all the patients. Bodies are left to rot in the streets. The global economy tanked, with industries such as tourism, culture, events, and hospitality being among the hardest hit. Unemployment and poverty increased dramatically. The world may have lost up to 5 years in its efforts to end extreme poverty. By October 2020, there were over a million deaths due to COVID-19 worldwide. Do we want to experience this a second time? The COVID-19 pandemic is naturally caused and has a zoonotic origin, meaning it transmitted from non-human animals, likely bats, to us. But what if I told you that it could be a lot worse? What would happen if the cause wasn't natural, but artificial? Biotechnology is improving rapidly. The genetic modification of existing organisms or the creation of new ones is becoming easier and cheaper year by year.
Biotechnology could be a cure for diabetes, which is an autoimmune disease where the immune system kills off the islet cells in the pancreas that produce insulin.
This is Michael Montague, a research scientist at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health and a senior scholar at its Center for Health Security. He's also a research associate with the Future of Humanity Institute.
You could imagine a vaccine for cancer. You can imagine all kinds of things of that sort. Ultimately, anything that happens in our body is biology. Anything and all of that can be manipulated or altered or tweaked. And that's a very powerful thing. That has the potential to improve the lives of everybody.
But there's also a huge downside to this. If we're able to easily re-engineer human pathogens, someone might accidentally or deliberately create or spread a potentially disastrous disease. So what could an engineered virus look like? With the current pandemic, COVID-19 is spreading. It's a respiratory illness that kills between 0.2 and 1% of those infected, mostly older people or people with underlying conditions. Without face masks or social distancing, the risk of spreading the virus is very high. Symptoms arise between 2 and 14 days. We're lucky to be expecting a vaccine. But people could engineer viruses that are deadlier, that kill younger people, or that spread faster. They could also make it so that it infects many people before symptoms arise and that vaccines and treatments are difficult to discover. With the high amount of air travel nowadays, viruses can spread across the world like wildfire. A large percentage of humanity could be infected without anyone noticing it. Governments will be too late to respond. This could consequently kill millions, or in a severe case, even billions of people, wiping out a huge chunk of humanity. So, what can cause an engineered pandemic? Let's first take a look at how it could happen accidentally. In 2007, there was an outbreak of foot and mouth disease in the United Kingdom, which was traced to a lab working on the disease. 6 years earlier, the same disease broke out, and 6 million animals had to be killed in an attempt to halt its spread. The economic damages totaled £8 billion. The lab considered foot and mouth disease a highest category pathogen that required the highest biosafety level, BSL-4. Yet the virus escaped from a badly maintained pipe, leaking into the groundwater at the facility. After an investigation, the lab's license was renewed, but only 2 weeks later, another leak occurred. Even though no known other pathogen leaks have happened since 2007, another escape may be only a matter of time. Unfortunately, we don't have good data on how likely an escape is due to a lack of transparency about escape rates. Scientists in the Netherlands have already introduced mutations to the highly lethal bird flu virus to make it airborne between ferrets, which was easier than expected. They did this to see if it could easily mutate to a virus transmissible from human to human. The ferrets that got infected by the mutation luckily didn't die, suggesting bird flu might become less lethal once it becomes transmissible, but this remains highly speculative. If scientists publish information on how they engineer new or re-engineer old diseases, it could inspire ill-intentioned actors to create their own extremely dangerous viruses. Cults and terrorist organizations have used or have been interested in using bioweapons, When Al-Qaeda heard Western warnings about bioweapons, they were inspired to pursue bioterrorism themselves. A cult in Japan called Aum Shinrikyo wanted to make humanity go extinct by using biological and chemical weapons. In 1995, they released a chemical closely related to the extremely toxic nerve gas sarin on 5 trains, killing 12 commuters and seriously injuring over 50 people. Their attempts at large-scale anthrax attacks, however, were unsuccessful. Luckily, so far no non-state actors have been able to pose a global catastrophic threat. But with biotechnology becoming increasingly cheaper and knowledge more widespread, the risk may increase. War, too, poses a serious risk. In the past, we've already used non-engineered pandemics as weapons. There's a possibility that the Black Death was introduced to Europe in the 14th century by the Mongol army, by catapulting plague-ridden corpses over the city walls of Kaffa. When the British were conquering North America in the 18th century, they attacked the Native American population in Fort Pitt, or present-day Pittsburgh, by distributing items carrying smallpox. During the 20th century, 15 countries, including the US, the UK, and France, developed bioweapons programs. During the Second Sino-Japanese War, it's estimated that the Japanese killed 400,000 Chinese civilians by spreading cholera, anthrax, and plague. The Soviets spent billions and employed tens of thousands of scientists to weaponize diseases including smallpox, anthrax, and plague. They tried to increase their lethality, infectivity, and resistance to vaccines and treatment. They had reportedly more than 20 tons of smallpox and plague. A few accidental lethal outbreaks occurred, but the total death toll of biowarfare remains relatively small. This may be due to the fact that using bioweapons can easily backfire. It's very difficult to use them on just your intended targets, and there are other weapons that do a better job. As far as we know, at this moment in time, there aren't any state-run bioweapon programs trying to make viruses that pose an existential risk. But if the political climate becomes unstable and a great power war might happen, this risk could increase. During the World Wars, bioweapons were used across multiple continents, so we can't imagine that being the case for future world wars as well. A situation may arise where nations invest in building an arsenal of bioweapons, like what happened during the Cold War with nuclear weapons. So, what are the chances that engineered pandemics will wipe us all out?
No, I think that the argument for extinction-level events from artificial pathogens is profoundly weak. Profoundly. These complex systems, things like, you know, transmissibility, lethality, you know, that's a hard thing to predict, to actually engineer, you know, equivalent to you know, just ask yourself, how hard is it for record labels to predict which songs are going to be a hit? Until it hits the market, there's really no way to know. And that's a relatively simple situation. Which pathogen is going to be immunologically a hit? You might have dialed in this little detail just a little bit wrong. Oh, it killed the patient too fast to transmit it.
Toby Ord, senior research fellow at the Future of Humanity Institute, seems more concerned. In his 2020 book, he estimates that the chance of a naturally arising pandemic destroying humanity's future, such as by wiping us out or causing a collapse we never recover from, in the next 100 years is about 1 in 10,000. He suggests that an engineered pandemic, however, has about a 1 in 30 chance. Note that he says each number could easily be a factor of 3 higher or lower. It does, however, give an idea of how serious the threat of an engineered pandemic could be. You wouldn't want to fly in a plane with a 1 in 30 chance of crashing. Human extinction wouldn't only end the almost 8 billion people living today, but it would end any chance of a thriving future for humanity, cutting off vast numbers of future generations from ever having a chance to flourish. And a pandemic doesn't have to kill all of humanity in order to be catastrophic. If we assume his estimation, the risk of a pandemic that will not wipe out humanity but will cause significant damage is even higher. So, are there any meaningful efforts being made now to prevent this from happening? There are a couple of local and international organizations working on pandemic preparedness, but they don't get a lot of attention, and consequently, they don't have a lot of funding. The most famous international protection is the Biological Weapons Convention of 1972 that seeks to outlaw bioweapons. But the convention hasn't been quite successful in their mission, as multiple countries have been or are suspected to be in breach of the convention. The fact that they only have 4 employees and a smaller budget than your average McDonald's probably doesn't help. So, what can be done? Toby Ord gives the following suggestions in his book. Increasing the budget from the Biological Weapons Convention from $1.4 million to $80 million. Strengthen the WHO's ability to respond to emerging pandemics through rapid disease surveillance, diagnosis, and control. This involves increasing its funding and powers, as well as their research and development on the required technologies. Ensure that all DNA creation is screened for dangerous pathogens. Some form of international regulation could be needed. Increase transparency around accidents in BSL-3 and BSL-4 laboratories. Develop standards for dealing with information when writing papers and incorporate these into existing review processes. This is to make sure dangerous information doesn't get spread easily and falls into the hands of ill-intentioned actors. Run scenario planning exercises for severe engineered pandemics.
We're at the start of what's looking like it will be a severe pandemic. And there are problems emerging that can only be solved by global business and governments working together.
So something that every person can do to improve the security of biotechnology is to demonstrate via letters to representatives and petitions when they come up and whatnot, a concern about the issue. Obviously, everybody is concerned about biosecurity now, right? But 5 years after COVID, it'll be a memory. If the issue remains in the minds of policymakers, if 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 20 years from now, you know, policymakers are going to continue to think, well, yeah, we've got a biosecurity budget at NIH. We've got a biosecurity budget at the World Health Organization. Can we cut that? No, there's a lot of interest in that. That's good.
We can support organizations such as the Future of Humanity Institute that researches global catastrophic risks, including engineered pandemics, and work to prevent them. Other research institutions like the Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security focus exclusively on biological risks, but focus less on existential risks. As advice on donating and other individual actions can easily change in the future, we'll add a link to a page with up-to-date recommendations to the description of this video. For those of you who are really motivated to help prevent the spread of artificial pathogens, you can also shape your career path to help with pandemic preparedness. Roles in research and policy are especially useful for this. But keep in mind that if you're looking for a career to make the world a better place, there may be other problems that you judge as more important or that suit you better. More in-depth career advice on preventing pandemics can be found on the website of 80,000 Hours, a nonprofit that researches how you can best use your career to help solve the world's most pressing problems. We'll link relevant pages in the description of this video. Because of the coronavirus, we now know what it's like to experience a pandemic. We can ask ourselves whether we want to experience this again, or something even worse. The risks of an engineered pandemic happening are too high, but we can do our best to reduce these risks. Now that governments realize the impact a pandemic can have, it may be a good time to convince them to help prevent another one. We've tried our best to explain this topic as accurately as possible, but since we're human, there's a good chance we've made mistakes. We welcome discussion on the issue raised and feedback on our presentation of it in the comments section below. We'd also love to know if this video has impacted you in any way. If it's inspired you to support certain organizations, shape your career path differently, or if you just informed your friends, feel free to share that with us in an email or in the comments below.